Welcome, everyone. I'm Bob Zielmick, MCLA's Vice President of Institutional Advancement and the President of the MCLA Foundation. Thank you for joining us this afternoon for the MCLA Foundation's first, or I should say, inaugural Endowment Summit. When we conceived this event last fall, it was our hope to provide helpful insight into the good work that the MCLA Foundation accomplishes each year in service of our current and future students, and how the foundation continues to steward and grow the investments that you all have entrusted with us. It is an immense privilege to do this work, and I know that I can speak for the members of the foundation's board of directors, some who have joined us here tonight, that it is also joyful and rewarding. I'm now pleased to introduce Chair of the Foundation Board, Julie Arnold. Chair Arnold graduated from MCLA in 1994 with a business degree. Today, she is principal in the accounting firm of Gaija Arnold and McConnell, PC, located in Williamstown, Mass. Please welcome Chair Julie Arnold to share greetings.
Thank you, Bob. Good evening, everyone. As Foundation Board Chair, it is my pleasure to welcome you here tonight. I want to take a moment to thank all of the donors who have supported the MCLA Foundation Endowment over the years. As you will hear today, it is because of you that our foundation has been able to grow to more than a $20 million organization. This is important because in simple math, the larger we grow the foundation, the more students we can help secure a life-changing education. I also want to thank all the foundation coordinators and board members on the call this evening. Your work and support is a key factor in our success. I hope you enjoy this evening's presentations and will continue to help our foundation grow over the next year and beyond. Thank you.
Thank you, Julie. Appreciate you being here in support of our first Endowment Summit. We developed a chart in order to show you historical growth of the MCLA Endowment since 1992. Mark Morandi from the Advancement Office, our resident endowment expert, tells me that the beginnings of the MCLA endowment can be traced back to three gifts made to the college that totaled approximately $30,000 from the Lilly, Redman, and Quinton families. All were to support scholarships. That balance transferred to the foundation in the early 1990s. In 1989, then North Adams State College hired its first development director, Carolyn Sanzone, to develop a professional fundraising program. Almost three decades have passed, and you can see that that decision has paid off with substantial growth to today as we sit at 16 plus million in our endowment. One theme that rang true throughout all those years was the desire to keep increasing the scholarships to help students and families. We have had some good earnings over the years, except for in 2008. We all know what happened that year. But principal from gifts has driven the growth. I thought a little context would be helpful going into our next segment. So now I'm pleased to introduce Rob Abel to provide us with an update on the health and growth of the foundation's endowment. Rob joined Mountain One Investments in 2001 and has over 19 years of experience as a financial services professional. As a principal at Mountain One Investments, Rob provides comprehensive investment, financial planning, and life insurance services to individuals and organizations. He specializes in retirement plan advising and advisory-based asset management. He is registered as an investment advisor representative of the Commonwealth Financial Network. Welcome, Rob.
Thanks a lot, Bob. I appreciate being here today. What an amazing spring day it is today. It's a lot to look forward to as we move through this year. I'll start just by talking a little bit about Mountain One Investments, who we are and where we came from. Our beginnings go back to the late 1990s when a gentleman named Dick Lamb, you probably have heard that name. He's a longtime friend and former board president, I believe, of MCLA, started a company called True North Financial. True North started working with this foundation in the early 2000s. I looked back and at that point, we were managing $1.4 million in assets for the foundation. Through the 2000s, True North saw some incredible growth, and it became clear that we needed a different partner or a larger partner. And in 2010, we partnered with a company called Commonwealth Financial Network. They provided us with state-of-the-art technology, the compliance services that became important for a growing firm, incredible research capabilities, a wider array of investment strategies, and really allowed the advisors, including myself at the time, True North, to really focus on clients and working with institutions like MCLA. Today, Commonwealth is the largest privately held independent RIA broker-dealer in the United States, and they continue to be a real good partner for us and allow us to do some good work for our clients. And here at Mountain One Investments, we're very quickly approaching a goal I set in 2002. We're sneaking up on $1 billion in assets under management. Which again, thinking back to when I started that True North, we were well under $100 million. So an exciting goal that's coming soon. And again, most of that money in the Berkshires, which is pretty incredible. We're really proud of our success, and we're proud of the good work we do in the community as well. This foundation is incredibly important to us for a number of reasons. We obviously take pride in working with such a prominent institution in our community, and it's incredibly rewarding to know that where this success and where this money goes and changes kids' lives for forever. As the investment advisor, our main role is to manage the portfolio of stocks, bonds, mutual funds, exchange traded funds, and ensure that we have an allocation and an account that is in compliance with the investment policy statement that we helped write for the foundation. Jay Durand, an MCLA grad who's an incredible resource locally for us at Mountain One. Jay and I meet with the Endowment Trust Committee quarterly to review the overall portfolio, discuss the holdings, evaluate performance, and often just provide an update of what's going on in markets, what's going on in the economy. We don't ever predict too much, but just being aware of what's happening in all of those important areas. When it comes to our investment philosophy, some people would call us pretty boring. We are long-term investors. We believe in having a well-diversified portfolio. With the foundation account, we use both actively managed portfolios as well as passive or index strategies. Our active positions have provided consistent value in terms of risk-adjusted returns. We obviously watch that carefully. And the index funds allow us to get access to certain segments of markets at really low cost. We're very fee conscious and try to be, own the right things at the right times. For an account like this, we also really believe in dividend producing strategies. The biggest holding in the portfolio is an index fund that actually tracks companies that have grown dividends over the past 5 years, companies like Microsoft, Johnson & Johnson, and Procter & Gamble. However, we also know that we need to own growth strategies, and we do. An example would be a T. Rowe Price New Horizons Fund, which has been a spectacular performer for more than a decade. This fund will look for smaller companies, possibly even not even in the public sector yet. They own Twitter, for example, before it went public, which has obviously been a great investment for that fund and for the foundation. But basically, we're looking for managers who have proven an ability to consistently outperform. Today, the foundation account is about 65% stocks and 35% fixed income. In our industry, that's considered a balanced account, an account that wants to grow and is exposed to growth potential, but one that realizes there will be downturns in the market and wants some sort of protection from those times. We constantly rebalance the account. That's something that we do on a regular basis. When markets rise, we need to adjust the portfolio to reflect the overall risk that the committee has charged us with. Similarly, when markets decline, we also make that adjustment. 2020 was a perfect example of this. As the markets collapsed in March of 2020, we were buying stocks to maintain that 65% equity target. It's not easy, it's not fun, it's scary, but as we saw markets recover through 2020, we were doing just the opposite. We were peeling off gains on that portfolio as well. Each quarter, we provide performance metrics to the committee. Our performance is benchmarked against a blended mix of four industries that represent a 65-35 portfolio. All the benchmarks are standard in our industry and attempt to replicate the risk that we're taking in the portfolio. While we don't always outperform in short periods, we're very proud of our long-term track record. 10 years ago, the investment portfolio was valued at about $7.5 million. Since then, just under $2 million has been deposited and about $1.5 million was withdrawn. Today, the account sits at over $16.5 million, so an investment gain of about over $8 million. To give you a little bit of track record, in 2020, the account gained just under 14%. And while this did trail our blended benchmark by about 1%, as we look at why we underperform or why we outperform, in that particular time, we went into the year holding a lot shorter duration bonds, being cautious about rising interest rates, and that held back the portfolio. Again, we have a value lean. We like big established companies more than we do the growth side of things for an account like this. So that was another reason of the underperformance. But turn it to 2021 and those strategies, those same exact strategies are actually outperforming and helping the portfolio. In 2019, the account gained 21%, right in line. In 2018, down 5%. And then positive 17% and positive 7.5% in 2017 and 16, both years outperforming the benchmarks. So where are we now? Obviously, we're coming off of an incredibly difficult 2020 and still dealing with the pandemic. If we look back to March last year, there were days when markets were down 8, 9, 10, 12%. At one point, the S&P 500, an indice that represents the large U.S. companies, was down about 30% for the year. Again, sticking to the strategy, not panicking, realizing that this account is invested for the long term, as painful of it as it was, certainly paid off and was the right thing to do. Today, we see a combination of improving fundamentals across the board, but maybe some exuberance and frothiness in the markets. Obviously, we've had a massive loss of jobs, but we're seeing that improve. We're seeing consumer confidence improving and spending. Profits have been pretty solid. Further stimulus, which we just saw provided, should give us another economic boost. It always has in the past, as well as a cushion for those people who are still unemployed. The Federal Reserve has been incredibly cautious with their interest rate environment, a huge help. And then lastly, we're very optimistic about how the ongoing vaccinations are going and people's willingness to get that done. And there's a fair amount of pent up demand. I think people are dying to travel, to see grandparents, to see grandkids, to move around, to go out to dinner, to go to breakfast. And I think as we get safer and safer, I think we're going to see, I hope we see a big boom there. We're cautiously optimistic. We use that term a lot. But we also remind ourselves that this is an account that's invested for, generations and generations of students at MCLA. And we don't take that responsibility lightly. So we will continue to work with the foundation committee do our hard work and research on managers and build portfolios that will continue to keep that chart that Bob showed earlier more and more yellow, more and more growth. So I guess at this point, I'm more than happy to take some questions if they're out there.
If you have questions for Rob, please put them in the chat, and we can I can moderate those questions for you. Well, Rob, it's looking like you were pretty thorough. We don't have lots of questions. So maybe later on in the program, some folks will have questions. Are you willing to hang around for us?
I can hang around.
We have questions for later on, but maybe they're still processing all the great information you just gave to us. So appreciate you being here, Rob. Thank you for
thank you.
Maybe check back in with you later if there's some questions.
Sounds good. Thank you.
Thanks, Rob. Well, I'm now pleased to introduce MCLA's 12th president, James F. Burge. Dr. Burge received his bachelor's degree from our sister school, Westfield State, a master's degree from Plymouth State in New Hampshire, and his PhD in leadership from Gonzaga University in Washington State. Since his arrival to MCLA in 2016, Dr. Burge has overseen a comprehensive strategic planning process, charged the President's Athletic Advisory Council with developing new athletic programs, hired the college's first chief diversity officer, guided a $10 million worth of renovations to the campus center that ended up with much better space for student dining and a brand new state-of-the-art fitness center. In addition, in 2019-20, under Dr. Burge's guidance, MCLA was awarded the Council for Advancement and Support of Education's National Fundraising Award for overall performance. At the same time, he continues to keep the college ranked in the top 10 of public liberal arts college in the U.S. News and World Report rankings. Please welcome President Burge for some remarks about our endowment.
Great. Thanks, Bob, so much for that introduction. I have to say that I am a proud graduate of Gonzaga University, where they have a great PhD program in addition to a basketball team. Rob, thank you for your report. I appreciate that information that you shared with us. It's always fascinating to watch to see how Mountain One investments really help us measure the market and make really good decisions. I'm proud of the board of directors for the foundation for the good work that they do to make decisions that help grow that fund. And as you saw from the chart that Mark developed for us, there's been really good growth over the years. I also want to thank Julie Arnold, the chair of the MCLA Foundation, and her fellow members for hosting this session. When the advancement staff approached me about this idea, I enthusiastically supported it. I hope that today's event gives all of us a closer look at not only how your gifts are being invested, but also how they're supporting our students, our faculty, our campus community on a daily basis. It's unquestionable the important things that happen here because of our partnership with the foundation. In fact, since 1977, the MCLA Foundation has provided crucial investment into the college. This is an incredible legacy for donors like you who choose to support the college through a charitable endowed investment. And I'm grateful for your partnership with us. With you, we've done incredible things over the decades, and we have you to thank for that. I want to share with you a snapshot of how the foundation has helped support the college's mission over the last 10 years. In the last decade, the MCLA Foundation has provided $1.8 million in endowed scholarship support for our students. We have students that are financially needy, and because of the foundation, we can meet that need so that students get access to a great public liberal arts education and they graduate without lots of debt. These scholarships range from straight financial aid to help students who've overcome extreme circumstances to attend and get their degrees here at MCLA. Also in the last decade, the MCLA Foundation has provided more than $1.4 million in programmatic support. This has allowed us to endow professorships, provide internship support for students, and provide the college with the opportunity to bring nationally recognized speakers to the campus. Speakers such as environmentalist Bill McKibben, journalist Cokie Roberts, Maria Hinojosa, Laura Ling, and Joy Reid. Over the coming decade, gifts to the MCLA Endowment are needed to support future growth and innovation at MCLA, but most importantly, to support our students directly. Our student profile is a very different profile than it was in 1977. Today, for example, nearly 50% of our students are eligible for federal support through a Pell Grant program. In last academic year, nearly 200 students, 20% of our students, came from households with less than $20,000 in family income. Think about that. 20% of our students come from families earning less than $20,000. They choose us because they know they can get a high quality liberal arts education and that they'll live a life that they wouldn't live if they attended somewhere else. So we need your support more now than ever before to support this population of students, many of whom are first generation college students. Scholarships not only help in the classroom, but with life-changing travel experiences and career-launching internships. Our endowment also is needed to help support the needs of our community, helping to eradicate the personnel shortage at our hospitals and healthcare centers through growing our health professions suite of programs and concentrations. Over the years, the MCLA endowment has been a key element to fostering students' academic and personal growth. I look forward to seeing steady growth within the endowment over the next decade, which will help MCLA to ensure that future trailblazers are ready to serve the world as engaged and resilient leaders of tomorrow. There can be no doubt that our world today needs more trailblazers. And it will be so because of your generosity. Thanks again for joining us this evening, and I hope you'll have some questions for Rob or for me or any of us, because we appreciate your partnership. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Dr. Burge. So I just wanted to throw out to everyone who's watching today that one of the things we wanted to do with this first Endowment Summit was to engage with you to answer your questions. So please put your questions in the chat, and we will take some time now to answer some. We do have one question that came in after Dr. Burge started to talk for Rob. And so Rob, I'll read that to you. Says it's an oddball question for Rob, but any interest or leanings or thoughts around engaging in cryptocurrencies as higher risk layers in the foundation portfolio?
Anytime there's new technology, new investment strategies, new ideas, we will be incredibly cautious getting into those areas and likely heavily lean on managers at fund companies to do the research, whether they think it's an appropriate investment within their strategy. There is absolutely no momentum at this point to move into a grayscale fund or something that is invested strictly into cryptocurrencies at this point for this this account here. I would be surprised if there wasn't some exposure in it and possibly increasing exposure in some of the funds that we use, like that New Horizons fund from T. Rowe Price. But I always say, if I don't understand it, I don't want to invest for my clients in that. And, I understand that crypto is a thing and it's real and it's coming. And but knowing who the winners are and who the losers are, I'll leave that to the management professionals. It's kind of a wimpy way out of saying that, we invest in funds and rely on managers to kick the tires of companies that we're investing in.
Thank you, Rob.
Thank you.
We have another question in the Q&A. This one is for President Burge. It says, Jamie, you touched on it briefly with the healthcare careers comment. Can you speak about MCLA's impact to local economic development? Hope you are on.
That's a great question. Thanks so much. I think everybody, of course, thinks of MCLA as an academic institution. And of course, we are. That's our core operations, our core purpose. But we're also an economic driver for the region. Because we are a public institution, we take that part of our mission very seriously. As I mentioned, we have new academic programs that we're developing or have developed recently to be directly responsive to some of the needs in the labor force here in Berkshire County. But it's even more than that. We have, on an annual basis, a direct contribution of about $16 million into the Northern Berkshire community, the economic engine here. And that's just direct when we think about paying 400 employees that live in our region, purchasing services and materials from local vendors, contractors and construction business that we have. But if you multiply those, as the U.S. Department of Labor suggests, and you look at some of the leveraged impact that we have, that economic impact very quickly grows to more than $100 million a year when we think about guests that we, visitors that we bring to the institution for different programs that we have. Less so this year, of course, because of the pandemic, but other years when we bring guests here, you know, thousands of people come for commencement every year. They stay in our local hotels, they eat in our local restaurants, they buy gas at our local stations. And so directly, it's about $15 to $16 million a year, but indirectly, we leverage about $1 million of more than $100 million of economic activity for the region. It's part of our mission, I think, and it's something that's important to us.
Another question for Rob. Rob, it says, any restricted industries?
Oh, okay, good question. Again, because we are using strategies that involve mutual funds, exchange-traded funds, rather than picking individual stocks, we don't have anything that's specifically restricted. What we do keep track of and report to the Endowment and Trust Committee every quarter is our exposure to the energy industry, specifically oil and gas. We have the capability to pull that out of the funds and look at the exposure in the total portfolio, and we're always in the extremely low single digits in terms of our energy exposure. At one point, there was some thoughts and ideas of eliminating that from the portfolio, but again, because of the way we use mutual fund and exchange traded fund strategies, we aren't allowed to tell them how to, and you know, what stocks to own within their portfolio. I hope that answers that.
Okay. So I have a question that came in through text for Dr. Burge. It says that a few years ago when Southern Vermont College closed, you brought some programs over, which I think was radiology. Is there any additional programs that are coming over from Southern Vermont College or new programs, such as you mentioned in health?
Yeah, sure. You know, we were sorry to see Southern Vermont close, as we are any institution. It's a sad ending to a long tradition of offering education, but we knew we wanted to be very helpful for them, particularly their students. And so we entered into an articulation agreement where we would teach out their students. And we've done that. Their students came to us a number of programs that we shared with Southern Vermont. But it is in fact the case that we saw their a real opportunity with their radiological science program, which we now call radiological technology, to take that program, faculty and students and all, and some equipment, and establish that program here on campus. And so we've done that. It's been successful for us. It's helped to expand our suite of health professions programs. Prior to that, we had created a health sciences major and a public health and community educator program. And so that's helped to round that out. As part of our strategic plan that we established in 2017, one of those elements was to look at how we can continue the pioneering spirit of creating new academic programs that are responsive to the needs of our students and our communities. And so one of the areas we're looking at right now very closely is nursing. We are working together with Berkshire Health Systems, who's been a great partner for us and in lots of different ways over the years, but looking to see, is there a way for us to establish a nursing program that would feed the needs of Berkshire Health Systems, Berkshire County, and that helps to draw even more students here from outside of Berkshire County and find another way to retain that knowledge and those skills of those individuals. So we will continue to look at programs like that, especially programs that offer real opportunities for growth. If you look at the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics data, and the last time I looked a couple of months ago, 6 of the 10 fastest growing fields were in health professions. And so there's an opportunity for us to grow our enrollment as well as to be responsive to what the needs of our communities are.
Okay, we just had another question come in on the chat. I guess President Byrd, you or I could answer this question, but I'll put it to you if you want. Is a capital campaign being considered?
I think every college and university is always in the state of considering a comprehensive campaign. And in fact, we are in that stage. We are considering that. The comprehensive campaign will focus on the opportunities for us to enhance facilities so that we can, in fact, expand academic programs. We are looking at the possibility of enhancing our commitments to scholarship development for students. We're at the very early stages. Bob will talk about this a little bit more, I suspect, but we've established a strategic oversight committee to look at what the possibility is of us launching a comprehensive campaign. But we are at that very early stage of looking at a campaign. Bob, would you add something to that?
Yes, I think so. Any good campaign, you really need to go into it knowing what your constituency and those your stakeholders will support. And so we are working hard to understand that. And Julie and the foundation board have been doing yeoman work to make sure that we are ready and that we can support our students. It has been a tough year to launch this and do a study with folks sitting at home. We would all much rather be sitting in an auditorium somewhere talking to you face to face and presenting to you and then having an opportunity to talk with you afterwards and answer more questions. So that makes our business and studying a campaign harder. But we're doing the business and working through it. So our hope is that we will be able to complete this study this spring and hopefully be able to announce or at least announce internally that we are beginning the process of a major capital campaign. So hope that answers your question. I'm not seeing any more questions in the Q&A. So I think I will move on to the next part of the program and introduce our special guests. Kathy and Joe Arabia, they had never heard the words gliomatosis cerebrae, and I'm not know if I pronounced that right. I practiced, but I'm not sure I did. But they didn't know those words until their daughter, Anna Yangji, was diagnosed with terminal brain tumor in 2009. Anna was only 16 years old when she became an angel on Valentine's Day 2013, filled with love and grace. Losing Anna left Kathy and Joe with a need to do something more. They launched the AYJ Fund with the purpose of bringing smiles to kids with cancer, connecting kids with school and friends through technology, and supporting research and other brain cancers. In 2020, the Arabias moved their endowment to the MCLA Foundation and established the AYJ Scholarship Fund to honor their daughter's commitment to academic excellence and her desire to brighten the days of others through community service. The scholarship was awarded for the first time this year to a deserving MCLA student. Please join me in welcoming Kathy and Joe to share their story and their decision to entrust the MCLA Foundation with Anna's legacy. Kathy and Joe.
Hi. First off, thank you for inviting us to be part of this foundation's inaugural summit. It's a wonderful gesture, and we really appreciate it because it's just another venue for us to get what we do, what our mission is out there to the public, so we can help more people. It's a very, very, you know, rewarding thing that we're able to do. So with that said, going back, my connection to MCLA is a long one, going back to my first days at Mark Hopkins Elementary School in kindergarten. So I started there. I was there until the third grade, when I my brother and I were forced to go to a full-time school that provided lunch, and we transferred to St. Joe's parochial school just downtown. I graduated from there in 1967. Spent 6 years after that in the labor and industry in the textile printing company in Adams, and was able to figure out what I wanted to do, but knowing that I wasn't, college wasn't in my cards, I figured I needed to get a job that would be long-term, very, you know, dependable. So I applied for a position at MCLA as a custodian in a brand new building, Berkshire Towers. From that point, I moved up through the ranks to supervision, and became very active in the comings and goings of the college. You know, being able to support it financially with its various initiatives. Kathy and I are proud to say that we are part of the 1894 society, which, you know, we're very proud of that. And then, you know, moving on at the college, you know, being able to get college credits, over that period of time. To make a long story short, I ended up there working there 36 years, retiring in 2009. So I figured, well, with time in my hands and I had some college credits behind me, I said, well, I might as well just get a degree. So I enrolled in MCLA. I had a course planned. It would take me 9 years to get my degree based on the amount of credits I had. And my plan was to graduate in 2018, when my daughter would have graduated from college. She was an honor student, very focused, and you know, she was just a great student. So I figured, well, that would have worked. Unfortunately, 6 weeks after I started in 2009, we got the diagnosis. And for 3.5 years, we had to travel, you know, almost, it seemed like almost weekly to Boston for treatment. In between, you know, I was trying to maintain my studies. The administration and the faculty there, you know, helped me in any way that they could, and I'm so thankful for that. At that point, in 2013, on Valentine's Day, Anna passed away. So prior to that, we decided we would establish a scholarship fund, and then we would also establish a charitable fund dealing with cancer and helping other families with cancer. And had a real mission staked out for us to help families and to long-term find a research to be started for this particular cancer. So that's how these two organizations came about. But unfortunately, most of our time was spent fundraising for the cancer fund, that we didn't have time to do fundraising for the scholarship fund. So with the help of your wonderful people at Mountain One and Brendan Bullitt and Jay, we established an investment account, which grew exponentially over the 8 years, and decided that we would turn it over to MCLA as basically twofold. I felt that I needed to give something back to a college that gave so much to me, not just from its academic point of view, but, you know, being able to work in one place for that amount of time is very unique today. So I'm very thankful. So I thought that was a good way to establish, you know, giving back to what, you know, they gave me, and that's what we did. So with that point, I'd like to turn it over to Kathy and have her talk about the AYJ Fund, Cancer Research Fund.
So with the scholarship fund, we were Anna was a student at Drury High School when she was diagnosed. And so we were able to work with the foundation in having the scholarship targeted to a Drury High School student coming to MCLA, which was really important to us and was great. At the same time, we had other interactions with MCLA, with the AYJ fund that we had created. Our goal was to help support children with cancer. And there are three programs to that. One is a Smiles campaign program, where we help to try to brighten the days of children with cancer that are going through treatment and testing and all that goes along with that. So we help children locally and beyond, but some of the local things that we've done is we've held a outing for a boy that was going into surgery shortly and had him and his friends at Bosque for a day that he wouldn't be able to do again for a long time. We had another family, his last wish was to go to an indoor water park. So we sent him and his family to the indoor water park. We do a lot of gift items around the holidays to Dana-Farber's Jimmy Fund Clinic, the clinic at Bay State and Dartmouth-Hitchcock and others as well. We have a campaign, our program for Connections, which is connecting children to school and to their friends through technology. And so over this last year, that was very busy buying tablets and computers for kids that were doing remote learning. And that was really helpful to keep them connected also. But a big part of what we're doing is the research part. So our Cures program really is focused on research. And at the time that Anna was diagnosed, there was no research being done and there was no effective treatment for her type of brain tumor. And that to us was just unacceptable. And we worked with the doctors at Dana-Farber, the lead PD neuro-oncologist is internationally known. We had connected with a number of families through the internet and social media, and he had connections with physicians, and we helped to sponsor the first international conference on gliomatosis cerebri. And it was held in at Curie Institute in Paris. And while we were there, the doctor that led the program at NIH came over to us, had recognized the name, asked us if we were from North Adams. And as it turns out, it was Kathy Warren who had graduated in 1982 from what was then North Adams State College. She was now, at the time, was leading the program at National Institute of Health. And so she hosted the second international conference that we had there. And now she's at Dana-Farber leading the pediatric neuro-oncology program. And we're helping support some of her research. And having those connections along the way has been pretty incredible. Of course, this last year has been challenging in terms of both getting to the kids what they need and also in fundraising. But we've been lucky that we've been able to have wonderful supporters from this community and from family and friends and be able to not skip a beat on the programs that we've been able to invest in children and through research. One of the fundraising programs that was canceled was a princess concert that we did every year that the Allegrettos hosted for us at MCLA. And that was a lot of fun. So we're hoping to do that one again as we get back to normal.
And this year it was an exceptional year for us because our foundation, as grassroots and as small as it is, and with the majority is local connections and supporters, hit a milestone. We have raised over $500,000 in over 8 years to go towards our various programs. And that being said, out of the last conference in 2019, which was held in Barcelona, Spain, from the information that was taken from that conference, we now have awarded a three-year grant of $300,000, which will be administered over 3 years for a specific GC research program, which in collaboration with four institutions, Dana-Farber, Italy, Spain, Dana-Farber, Italy, France, yeah, and England. And that'll be starting very soon.
And that's a collaborative group with five different foundations. And some of that is going here to Dana-Farber with the program that Kathy Warren leads there. So we've come full circle.
Well, thank you, Kathy and Joe, for sharing your story.
Thank you.
And we're just very excited that you've entrusted us with scholarship, and just amazed at all the work that you've been doing for the last 8 years. It's just wonderful. And if folks have questions for Kathy and Joe, or more questions for President Burge or Rob Abel, or for others, please put them in the chat. We're coming to the end of the program, so we would, you know, if you have questions, we'd love to have them now. Not seeing any. I guess we all were just very thorough in our presentations. not a lot of questions today. So, but I'll give a few more minutes as people hopefully are typing or thinking about questions before we decide to say this is the end of our first summit. But we wanted to give people an opportunity. Doesn't look like there's questions, Kathy and Joe. So we'll. So I want to thank everybody for joining us this afternoon. We are really deeply appreciative of all the support of all the donors that are here today, and appreciative of it because it helps us to really focus on MCLA's mission of elevating students' lives every day. And thank you, and have a great evening.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody.